Happy New Year! Welcome to Jung Tuition. I am Jung. Let's continue discussing basic issues in climate research since 1860, the year when John Tyndall observed infrared absorption by water vapor, CO2, and other gases. I would like to take this once-a-year opportunity to make some remarks on the state-of-art climate research. Based on my intensive, in-depth, and independent investigations over the past few years. I'm sure you'll be delighted by watching this unique talk, no matter what your opinions might be. So, are you ready? I mean to like, to share, and to subscribe, and as well to activate your little bell. Okay, let's go and have fun. It is well known the Earth is primarily covered by water, two-thirds to be exact. Therefore, it is not surprising at all that it has been generally accepted that water vapor in the atmosphere plays a unique and dominant role in regulating the kinetic temperature profile from the surface up to space. This important idea was explained by Simpson in 1928, although he also accepted the back radiation associated with the greenhouse effect hypothesis. Unlike Arrhenius, who assumed the atmosphere is separated from the surface, Simpson first introduced the multilayer atmosphere model, which is physically attached to the surface. However, as in my reply to the viewer who sent the original paper to me last year, Simpson had unintentionally revealed the incurable defect inherited in the Arrhenius climate model, namely, the air temperature at the surface cannot be always higher than the surface temperature, as shown in this diagram. In essence, the net upward radiation has become model dependent. That's to say, the more layers one uses, the closer to zero the temperature difference would be between his model atmosphere and the surface. Simpson used a model atmosphere with a dozen of layers whose thickness is 1 kilometer and the napped rate is 6K over kilometer. Besides, he also used a mean temperature for the first layer immediately above the surface. In this case, the temperature difference between the first layer and the surface is 3 Kelvin, and the net infrared radiation is just 16 watts per meter squared if we assume the surface temperature is 288 Kelvin. Notice that if one uses more layers with a thickness, say 1 meter, then the temperature difference would be 0.003 Kelvin, and the net infrared radiation to the atmosphere would be almost zero. This zero and asymptotic surface radiation was what I proposed last year. What does this zero surface radiation mean? It means the surface cannot be cooled down by radiation. Of course, this is due to basic laws in thermodynamics rather than the imagined back radiation. In his 1896 paper, in fact, Arrhenius avoided explicitly using the idea of back radiation in his argument. Instead, he carefully just used the term net heat transfer from the surface to his atmosphere model. It could be argued that Arrhenius knew back radiation is a bad idea. In doing so, Arrhenius implied the atmosphere and the surface were separated by vacuum layer, which is not real. So far, unfortunately, many people are still unaware of this fact. Others simply pretend such fundamental flaw doesn't exist. Why do I repeatedly discuss the implication of zero surface infrared radiation? Because ever since the Tyndall's experiment in 1860, it has been the central issue in climate research whether or not some trace elements such as CO2 can absorb a substantial amount of infrared radiation emitted from the surface. And hence, the surface temperature could be controlled by CO2 concentration in the atmosphere. Apparently, the zero surface radiation hypothesis implies that no gases can directly absorb energy from the surface by means of radiation. At most, CO2 could either absorb thermal energy, that's to say, thermally excited itself in the atmosphere, or absorb the infrared ray emitted by water vapor and clouds, and then relay the energy into the space if CO2 molecules are well above the troposphere. But the contribution from CO2 to the outgoing infrared radiation is a trivial, certainly not determinant, because as Simpson explained as early as 1928, that it is water vapor and clouds that are responsible for maintaining the just right amount of the outgoing infrared radiation to space by this planet, or commonly called OLR. Based on his quantitative computations, Simpson argued that the OLR to a large degree of the latitudes on both sides of the equator. Several climate research groups, such as Bjorn Stevens and GVG, called his idea as Simpson's law. Therefore, Simpson's law seems unwanted for those climate researchers who believe the imagined imbalance caused by increasing CO2 can be fixed up if and only if the surface temperature increases, which is childish and absurd. On the other hand, since Manabay and Weatherford published their paper in 1967, it has been known that the global mean OLR depends linearly on the surface temperature. It has been recently re-examined by Cole and Corney in relation to water vapor feedback, which I think they had missed the essence. Although I also derived an analytical linear equation with the slope 3.3 compared to Manabe's 2.3 and the Cole's result 2.2. This linear relation has been directly used to estimate the most wanted climate sensitivity in the popular global warming narrative, because it converts the change in outgoing infrared radiation in watt per meter square into the exact change in the surface temperature in degree Celsius or Kelvin. Nevertheless, it should be made clear that this equation is obtained by assuming CO2 concentration is a constant. In other words, it is by no means guaranteed that the reduction in OLR by increasing CO2 can be definitely counteracted by increasing the surface temperature. Therefore, it is not surprising that the MIT group is still uncertain to what extent such a simple linear equation is forbidden by Simpson's law. Based on my published research, the outgoing radiation at the top of atmosphere also depends on the lapse rate, which in turn is determined by the humidity in the troposphere. This implies that the outgoing infrared radiation can be regulated by changing the humidity without affecting the surface temperature. It could be argued that such a natural mechanism for the Earth to adapt to both internal and external perturbations, such as sunspots and geothermal eruption, has been underestimated. For example, the tropospheric lapse rate was treated as a fixed parameter by many climate researchers. In principle, should the outgoing radiation were slowed down by the increase in CO2 or blocked, which I disagree, then the cumulative thermal energy surplus can easily be emitted by water vapor at different wave numbers beyond the CO2 absorption band. As everyone knows the saying, all roads lead to Rome.
Except for those bloody climate researchers.
Who said that?
A discussion that is alarmist. I am here factual and I respect the science. And there is no science out there or no scenario out there that says that the phase out of fossil fuel is what's going to achieve 1.5. 1.5 is my North Star. And a phase down.
Back in the West. Nevertheless, over the past 160 years, many climate researchers have claimed that the temperature near the surface must increase because a fraction of the infrared emission channels were blocked by CO2 and other greenhouse gases, as shown in this diagram. From Arrhenius to IPCC, this claim has been treated as the words of the high priest.
People of Eurasia, the vile and ruthless aggressors who have committed countless atrocities and who are guilty of every bestial crime a human being can commit.
As I have discussed so far, many basic issues in climate research remain to be further explored. In particular, the assumption of the back radiation that magically reduces the imagined surface infrared radiation and the fabricated absorption and emission spectra of CO2 that could be observed from a satellite. I will be here to explain, demonstrate, and evaluate what has been going wrong and what has been recently found in order to provide systematic but easy to use guidelines or entrances for all people who would like to discover what has been going on behind the climate research. Please make comments and ask questions. I will prepare my coming talks based on your concern and curiosity. Thank you for watching. Thank you for donation. See you next time.